Please welcome radio show host, author, and attorney, Larry Elder.
Thank you all so much for having me. It's another great event. I hear 2,000 people are here. And then I hear later on Jack Phillips of the Masterpiece Cake Theater, Cake Shop, is going to be here to talk about how he's been forced to try to bake a cake for a gay wedding. You know, we've got a country to save. Let me give you the Cliff Notes version of how I got into talk radio. I'm born and raised in Los Angeles. I'm a lawyer, but I was living and working in Cleveland. And I began writing articles for newspapers. And every now and then, I would just submit them. I didn't have a deal. I would just submit them cold, and one got published. And the article was all about my assertions 30 years ago that racism was no longer a serious impediment for black progress in America, that the biggest problem was the breakdown of the black family. The biggest problem is the failure of homes to emphasize education. So I get a phone call from a producer of a radio show. He says, "Are you black?" I said, "I think so." He said, "You believe that racism is no longer a major problem in America?" I said, "That's right." He said, "Would you come on my guy's show tonight and talk about it?" I said, "Sure." So I was on for an hour. Now, Cleveland is about 50% black. So every other caller was a black man or a black female. And I was called an Uncle Tom, a bootlicking Uncle Tom, a foot shuffling bootlicking Uncle Tom, Sambo, coconut, as in brown on the outside, white on the inside, Oreo, same concept. I was called the Antichrist. And finally, I was called the word that you really call a black person when you really want to cut him and hurt him. I was called Republican. A man can only take so much. But what I wasn't called was wrong. When I talked about the breakdown of the family in this country, in 1965, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who later on became a Democratic senator from New York, wrote a report called The Negro Family, A Case for National Action. At the time, 25% of blacks were born outside of wedlock. And Moynihan thought this number was horrific, that it was going to grow, and if we didn't do something to intervene, there was going to be a horrible breakdown in the inner city, education was going to be de-emphasized, the economy was going to suffer. Fast forward, 70% of black kids today are born outside of wedlock. 25% of white kids today are born outside of wedlock. 40% of all kids in America today are brought into the world without a father in the home. Forget about Larry Elder. Barack Obama once said, "A kid raised without a father is 5 times more likely to be poor, 9 times more likely to drop out of school, 20 times more likely to end up in jail." It is far and away the number one problem facing this country. The attack on the basic fundamental premises of this country, it's frightening. It is frightening when you have 65% of Democrats having a positive view of socialism. Only 55% have a positive view of capitalism. One of the strong candidates on the Democratic side, as you know, is a self-described socialist. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Who would have thought 2 years after the election and re-election of the first black president, we'd be talking about reparations? Did you have any idea? Do you think Barack Obama would have gotten elected if people thought 2 years from now we'd be talking about reparations? The whole idea was to show that this country has gotten to the place where somebody who's qualified and competent in the minds of the Democrats could be nominated and could get elected president of the United States. In the mid-60s, Martin Luther King gave an interview. And he said, "I'm surprised at how quickly things are changing. Things are getting so much better so quickly. I think in about 40 years' time, there could be a black person elected president." It almost happened exactly 40 years. Now, the reason he said president is because that's a pinnacle. A majority white country electing a black person for president, what does that say? It says that racism is no longer the impediment that it used to be, for crying out loud. Knock it off. Knock it off. Joe Biden gives an opinion on busing, which is identical to the position that Kamala Harris has, and he's racist? Joe Biden simply says the same story he told many years, that he is civil with people with whom he disagrees. "I'm civil with Eastland. I'm civil with Talmadge. I can be civil with these guys." By the way, they're on the same party. and he's called racist. Never mind, Bill Clinton gave a eulogy before Robert KKK Byrd's funeral. And in 1973, Ted Kennedy, look it up. There was a July 4 rally for George Wallace, that George Wallace, the one who stood in front of the school door and said, segregation now, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. Ted Kennedy flattered him, praised him. 1973, look it up. Nobody said anything. So all poor Joe Biden does is talk about my ability to get along with people. He's trying to make the argument that unlike Trump, I can bring the other side with me, and he's hammered. That's the race card the Democrats have played. They've used it as a sword, as a shield, and now it's coming back to bite them. It is outrageous that the Democrats believe that Donald Trump is a racist. I had a caller once. I said, sir, tell me the number one thing that Donald Trump ever said that makes him a racist. He said, well, he once said, I don't want black people counting my money. I said, you're referring to the book that somebody put out who'd been fired by Trump. No one was able to corroborate it. I said, that's all you got? That's it? Let me help you. How about Donald Trump entering into a consent decree when he ran his dad's business when he was 28 years old and agreed not to continue the practices that the FHA claimed were discriminating against blacks and against Hispanics? Never mind that the Trump family did have tenants who were black and Hispanic. They didn't want to rent to certain kind of Section 8 tenants, but that's what got Donald Trump and Donald Trump Jr. in trouble. I said, they signed a consent decree, did not admit any guilt. And by the way, go online and, this was in the 70s, go online and type in Donald Trump Jesse Jackson and see what happens. Donald Trump Al Sharpton and see what happens. Donald Trump John Johnson, the former president of Ebony Magazine, see what happens. A bunch of pictures of them hanging out with Donald Trump. So if Donald Trump was disqualified by entering into this consent decree, why do you suppose all these black leaders kept hanging out with him? That's all you got? And then, of course, he brought up the Charlottesville incident. How many times is Donald Trump going to be willfully misquoted on what he said in Charlottesville? The man specifically was talking about the issue of whether or not there should be Confederate monuments in the public square. That's what he was talking about. He even said, in case you missed it, quote, verbatim, quote, and I'm not talking about the neo-Nazis and the white nationalists because they should be condemned totally, end of quote. And they still keep saying, he said, there were good Nazis and bad Nazis and good white nationalists and white and bad white nationalists. They know darn well he didn't say it, but they're using the race card. That's exactly what they've done with Joe Biden. Misconstrued his words on busing on purpose, misconstrued his words on civility on purpose to use the race card against him. How does it feel, Joe? How does it feel to constantly use the race card against Republicans? And now to find it biting you. How does that feel? You know that Ronald Reagan was called a racist, of course. William Clay, whose son is still in Congress, William Clay Sr., said that Ronald Reagan wanted to replace the Bill of Rights with the precepts from Mein Kampf, end of quote. I kid you not. Maxine Waters called George Herbert Walker Bush a racist. I thought that was a good one. I thought that was the one everybody liked. George W. Bush, of course, was called a racist by, among other people, Barney Frank. Barney Frank, the congressman from Massachusetts, said that the reason George W. Bush responded sluggishly to Hurricane Katrina was because he wanted to engage in, and I'm quoting him, ethnic cleansing by inaction, close quote. Honestly, these are the people we've got to deal with, and they are vicious. And what they don't like is this president, for the first time, has taken on the media like nobody else has. Hallelujah, it's about time. This is a marvelous country. We all hit the lottery when we were born here. There are 7 billion people in the world, and I dare say the majority of them would trade places with us if they could only get here. And if you were lucky enough to be born with two parents, you really hit the lottery. And that's my case. I had a hardworking mother, hardworking father. They were married 56 years. My lifelong Republican dad. My lifelong Republican dad and I did not get along. I thought he was mean and harsh and cold and ill-tempered, and I wondered why he got mad so often. And when I was growing up, I kept telling myself, I'm gonna get big enough and strong enough to kick his butt someday. So now I'm 15 years old and my dad starts a little cafe. So now I have to start working for him. And I hated working for him. He would yell at me sometimes when he thought I did something wrong. I didn't feel that I deserved the yelling. So I told myself, I'm 15 years old now, next time the SOB yells at me, I'm going to walk out. I would like to tell you, I said, the next time the SOB yells at me, I'm going to sit him down and say, you and me, mano and mano, let's have a conversation. But I was afraid of my father. So my dad yelled at me, I took off the apron, I walked out. That was an act of defiance that no one had ever done to my dad. He got home, he was furious. He said, why did you leave? And I said, I got sick and tired of the way you spoke to me. My dad paid me $10 a day plus tips. He balled up the $10, he threw it at me as I lay on my bed. He walked out of my bedroom, and my father and I did not have a conversation for 10 years. And when I say not have a conversation, I mean nothing. Not even, do you think it's going to rain? How about those Rams? It was easy to avoid him because he worked long hours. And then I graduate from high school. I go to law school in the East Coast, to college in the East Coast, law school in the Midwest, and end up working in the Midwest in Ohio. So now I'm 25 years old. I just passed the California bar, the Ohio bar. I've got a job with a major law firm. I'm making a tremendous amount of money. I'm 25 years old. I should be living large, and I can't sleep. But I know it has to do with something with my father. And I called my secretary and I said, canceled all my appointments. I'm flying to LA. I'll be there for a couple of days. I'll come back. I figured I'd talk with my dad for 5 or 10 minutes. I called him an SOB. He called me an ungrateful son. At least the air would be cleared. Maybe I could sleep. So I walk into the restaurant, 1:30. They close at 2:30. I had 2 big bags. My dad was shocked to see me, of course. He said, Larry, should I put your bags in the back? I said, no, Dad. I'm only going to be here for 5 or 10 minutes. I want to tell you something. He said, okay, wait till we close. So I sat for an hour. And I said to myself, Larry, don't tee off on the man. Just give him the highlights. And he'll probably tell you that you're an ungrateful son, and who knows, maybe you'll be able to sleep. So my dad sat there, and I teed off on him. You guys have seen how I can go. So I spoke for 20 minutes nonstop. I told him everything he'd ever done, every whipping, every spanking, every slight, everything. Finally, I was out of ammo, and my dad looked up and he said, is that it? You didn't speak to me for 10 years because of that? And I said, yeah. And my dad said, let me tell you about my father. Now, let me pause here. I know my dad is an only child. I knew he had no relatives. We never got any presents. Beyond that, I knew nothing about his life, and I didn't like him anyway, so I didn't give a damn. And my dad said, you know your name, Elder? I said, yeah. He said, that's not my biological father. I said, who's your biological father? I have no idea. Well, who's Elder? Well, Elder was the boyfriend in my mom's life the longest, maybe 4 years, so I took his name. But she had a series of boyfriends, each one more irresponsible than the one before. She was illiterate. I don't know my birth date because I wasn't born in a hospital. And I'm 13 years old, my dad said. And I come home and I start quarreling with my mom's then boyfriend. He said, my mom sided with the boyfriend and threw me out of the house, age of 13, never to return. A black boy, Jim Crow South, Athens, Georgia, at the beginning of the Great Depression. I defy you to find somebody who had a handout like that. I said, well, Dad, what did you do? He said, I walked down the road. I did anything I could. Ultimately, he said, I became a Pullman porter on the trains. And because I was able to travel all around the country, I came to California one day and I said, things look sunny and people seem less racist. Maybe someday I'll relocate out here. Pearl Harbor, my dad joins the Marines. I said, Dad, why the Marines? He said, 2 reasons. They go where the action is, and I love those uniforms. My dad was stationed on Guam. The bombs fell. He goes back to Chattanooga, where he had met and married my mom, to get him a job now as a short order cook because he was in charge of cooking facilities. Became a staff sergeant in charge of cooking facilities in the Marines. He went to restaurant to restaurant to restaurant, and they told him, I'm sorry, we don't hire niggers. My dad went to the unemployment office. Lady said, you went through the wrong door. He said, which door? She said, go through that one, colored only. He goes through that door to the very same lady who sent him out. He came home to my mother and said, this is BS. I'm going to Los Angeles. I'm going to get me a job as a cook, and I'll send for you. My dad goes out to LA by himself, walks around for 2 days. I'm sorry, sir, you have no references. My dad said, I cook for the military. I'm sorry, sir, you have no references. My dad said, I'll cook for free, just give me a reference. They wouldn't even do that. They treated him the same way in LA as Chattanooga, just a little more polite about it. Went to an unemployment office, just took one door this time, one office. My dad sat for a day and a half. He said, I'll take anything you have. It was a job as a janitor. My dad cleaned toilets at Nabisco Bread Nabisco brand bread for 10 years, took a second job with another bread company cleaning toilets, worked for a family on the weekends to get additional money, and went to night school two or three nights a week to get his GED. The man never slept, which is why he was so cranky all the time. And so as my dad is speaking, he's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. I'm getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and I'm crying now. And I said, Dad, forgive me for being so harsh. Forgive me for judging you this way. And my father said, you don't need forgiveness. You didn't understand. Just follow the instructions I've always given you and your brothers. Hard work wins. You get out of life what you put into it. And Larry, you cannot control the outcome, but you are 100% in control of the effort. And before you moan about what somebody did to you, go to the nearest mirror, ask yourself, what could I have done to change the outcome? And finally, Larry, no matter how good you are, how hard you work, sooner or later, bad things will happen. How you deal with those bad things will tell your mother and me if we raised a man. I wrote about all this in a book entitled A Lot Like Me, because after this 8-hour conversation, by the way, it took 8 hours, I found out my dad was a lot like me. He was a lifelong Republican. He hated the Democratic Party. He said, Democrats want to give you something for nothing. And when you try and get something for nothing, you almost always end up getting nothing for something. Thank you very much for having me. Stay strong, stay focused. This is a marvelous country. God bless you, and may God continue to bless the United States of America. I love you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.